found out, luckily enough, that some songs wrote themselves. Like Teenage Kicks wrote itself. Teenage Kicks was written in a matter of 20, 30 seconds. And I remember doing it at the time and thinking, where did that come out of, you know?
First time in Undertones and Teenage Kicks.
Teenage dreams, so hard to beat.
In October 1978, millions of British viewers got their first taste of Teenage Kicks and their first glimpse of the Undertones. Five lads from Northern Ireland who created some of the most sublime pop music ever made. The Undertones were inspired by the angry anarchy of punk. But theirs was a different kind of rebellion. Their singer was a choir boy. They sang of girls, or the lack of them, mummy's boys, and their irritating relatives. They created a perfect and timeless soundtrack to growing up that spoke to teenagers all over the globe. But their adolescent anthems were revolutionary nonetheless. Startlingly positive protest songs that demanded a life more ordinary. Because the Undertones came from Londonderry, epicentre of the violent troubles that tore Northern Ireland apart during the 1970s.
What you cannot overemphasise is just how unpleasant that place was. The Undertones were this extraordinary contrast to all that.
For me, the Undertones coming up with those great pop songs was just the most wonderful form of protest. 17, 18-year-olds in a very ridiculous, absurd, stressful situation, still managing to capture the almost abstract, universal exquisiteness of a great pop song.
The Undertones came from a place which was, on the face of it, mad with violence, raging with violence. And yet they emerged singing songs of trivial and conventional teenage angst.
Here was a band who somehow managed to produce something big and operatic and meaningful. And that was something really precious. They couldn't have happened anywhere else, and they couldn't have had the impact they had anywhere else.
This is the story of the most improbable pop stars from the most unexpected place. Between 1978 and 1983, the Undertones had a string of hit records that made them one of punk rock's most prolific and popular acts. They were one of a wave of bands inspired by the Sex Pistols' rousing call to rebellion and punk's DIY assault on the music industry and the world at large. But while the Pistols snarled out anarchy in the UK, you know, and the Clash raged about white riots and Sten guns in Knightsbridge, the Undertones sang of the everyday trials of teenage life and love. If you wanna
have someone to talk to. It wasn't as disruptive in an obvious way as the Clash or the Pistols, but what made the whole thing completely unique was that the need to escape, the need to create an alternative world, was so much on their shoulders that their response to their surroundings and their circumstances was to create this amazing guitar pop music that was just so infectious and so exhilarating.
Other punks may have seemed more radical, but what made the Undertones' music genuinely subversive is that it came from a place where bombs and guns were part of the walk to school, a city where an ordinary life was something that dreams were made of.
Tell your story. I'm gonna tell you about my town.
The story of the Undertones begins here in the tight-knit Catholic neighborhoods around the Bogside area of Derry. This was the childhood home of five mates: Michael, Billy, brothers John and Damien, and Fergal, who became one of Britain's most iconic bands.
So, where were the Undertones from in Derry? Well, start off with the highest altitude, which was us, up in Craigan. That was our house there, number 36 Craigan Broadway. From my house to O'Neill's house, I suppose, was just two streets away. 22 Beechwood Avenue, Undertones HQ.
22 Beechwood Avenue. This was the headquarters of where the Undertones kind of got together and the hub. You know, it was a gathering place.
Billy was a stone's throw from O'Neill's house over the Mur.
Okay, we're just here on the Lone Mur Road and my house, Elma Terrace, is just around the corner.
And Fergal would have been about 10 minutes walk. 53 Grafton Avenue. Where Fergal lived, certainly, would have been kind of lower middle class. But, you know, to an outsider, it would have all been working class. You know, it's not as if there was no leafy suburbs here. There were no Volvos parked outside. We were very lucky, I think, that... Well, I was certainly very lucky in that I was only a couple of streets away from John O'Neill, who wrote great songs, and only, you know, maybe about a mile away from Fergal Sherky, who's a great singer. Imagine Fergal had lived over there. Imagine Fergal had lived on the waterside. Imagine Fergal had been Protestant. Undertones would never have existed. That's the bizarre thing about Derry.
To the outside world, in the early 1970s, Northern Ireland's second city was famous as the home of Eurovision winner Dana. And as the place where the violent struggle known as the Troubles began.
Already the stones are flying and there's a whiff of CS gas in the air.
All kinds of everything remind me of you.
Growing up in Derry was no ordinary experience.
Derry wasn't one place, you see. There was Derry where the Troubles happened, which was down at the bottom of William Street. In terms of Troubles, I mean the Daily Riot. People in Derry will tell you that it was good crack down there, you know, apart from when things happened, when there was shootings, when there was serious stuff, but guys in my class would talk about being down and throwing stones. And of course, you had the prize of the rubber bullet, you know.
Summertime, wintertime.
You kind of knew it was cool to be from Derry. Whenever punk happened, and you read about the Clash talking about Sten Guns and Knightsbridge and so on, and great slogans, but the Clash would have killed to come from Derry. Because we all had our trouble stories.
There was an instance here around about the early 70s, I would have been about 14 years old, that there was a booby trap bomb. And the bomb was actually that strong that actually blew me up out of my bed. The windows came in, glass on top of me, the tiles came off the roof, the door came in as well. And then shortly after the explosion, the army came back again. I looked over here and I could see the soldier take an aim and he just shot up the road. And there's hundreds of people here. It was just complete.
Even then, we kind of knew that not, you know, they didn't have that in Manchester.
The history and geography of the Undertones' hometown made it unique. Derry was a divided city, where a large Catholic majority was ruled by a Protestant minority. A city with an uneasy, sometimes antagonistic relationship between Protestant unionists who supported ongoing British rule of Northern Ireland and those mainly Catholic nationalists who favoured Irish independence.
It's not an accident that the Northern Ireland Troubles started in Derry. Here you had a place like the Bogside and the Craigan, sort of the area down beneath the walls here. You had the biggest single concentration of working class Catholics in Northern Ireland. So people felt self-confident in their numbers. Or Catholic working class people in a place like the Bogside or in the Craigan estate did not have that sense of siege, of being besieged, that Catholic working class people in the sort of epicenters of violence in Belfast had. It's also important to understand about Derry is that from where we're standing, if you walk in that direction, or that direction, for 3 miles, you're in the Republic of Ireland. So there's no sense of isolation here. So Derry was a place where simultaneously working-class Catholics felt almost uniquely discriminated against, and that was true. But at the same time, Derry Catholics felt more self-confident than Catholics anywhere else in the North, and that was a strange combination. So at one and the same time, it was possible to feel that in Derry, we are being incredibly hard done by the world. And at the same time, aren't we great? To some extent, the Undertones captured that, sort of that Derryness.
You were aware of the political situation. You know, there was always rioting, there was always bombs, there was the army checkpoints were there to stop you every time, and you were hassled by the police. You just got used to it. Even though you were aware that was going on and how bad it was, you still wanted to have some sort of escape.
When you're about 14 or 15 and you realise you're not going to be a professional footballer, like the next avenue open to you would be form a band. So it was myself and John. I think we might have had like a mandolin and a set of bongos.
After we played football or something, come to our house and play some records, and there would always be a guitar lying about, and Billy was starting to be interested in playing the drums, and there was no great master plan or that initially, you know.
And then Finney was in the band as well.
We weren't out to change the world, it was just a bit of fun, you know.
In 1974, just like boys everywhere, Billy Dougherty and John and Vincent O'Neill decided that it might be a good laugh to form a band. Their next recruit came from around the campfire.
This is Bon Doran and Donegal, and in August 1974, we were camping down here. And I officially joined the as yet unnamed Undertones.
Goodbye to you, my trusted friend.
It was my best mate. And I think Biggie could play stuff like, you know, he could tune a guitar and all, the rest of us couldn't, you know.
Vinny was the first person who knew that they announced the new charts on a Tuesday lunchtime. He would go to his house, I would go to my house, we'd have our dinner. And then on the way back up from school, we'd discuss what it was. And I remember you really wanted Seasons in the Sun to be number one. I remember that, because I remember when Seasons in the Sun was number one. I remember leaving the house with a sense of, Funny, he'll be happy about that.
We had joy, we had fun, we had Seasons in the Sun.
The band was now four. They had friendship, they had a shared love of pop music. Next, they needed a singer.
Just going to look at the register here for 1971, 72 for my class, which was B4, which is second year. So where am I? William Edward Doherty. And in the same class, down the list, there you go, Shergey, Sean F. F. Fergal. Fergal was a cousin of mine, but he was also in my class, and whenever we were in music class with Mr. Bonner, he would ask the guys in the class, can anyone like play guitar or sing? And always Fergal sang. So he had some nerve to stand up in a class with 30 or 34 guys and sing.
Billy's cousin would grow up to become one of pop music's most original voices.
Fergal Sharkey, what a voice. That nasal, brilliant, amazing, totally unique, absolutely characterful voice. Which I think was the greatest voice to come out of punk. You know, where the hell did that come from?
Sharkey was an unlikely punk whose singing career began long before he joined the Undertones. Fergal was a child star, a champion of the annual Irish music festival called the Derry Fesh.
Fesh is actually a showcase for all parts of the arts, mostly for the for children of Derry to perform in and also to compete. It is competitive. My mother would have been anxious if we all sang or played an instrument, but it turned out he had a lovely boy soprano voice, and he had no nerves, you know. Fergal was always very confident about his singing. When he got into his stride, he was unbeatable. When one of the adjudicators, he sang "How Soft Upon the Evening Air," and she said it brought her to tears.
It was obvious he definitely had the balls to go up and sing for other people, you know. Even though he may not necessarily have been part of the gang as such.
Was he ever part of the gang? Probably not. Which is probably very unfair in him, because it's not as if he didn't have any other friends. He needed a singer, and we sought out a singer, whereas we didn't seek out anyone else in the band.
To the record-buying British public, Sharkey would come to define the Undertones. But he didn't write any of the songs he seemed to personify.
Fergal, you know, interestingly and unusually, was kind of old school. It was a bit like a kind of, you know, having Shirley Bassey wander in after the orchestra's put everything down. He'd sing the part and, "Thanks, Shirl, off you go." But he had very little input with, no input with the writing. He didn't actually originate any material on all the albums. He never wrote a thing.
While Sharkey was the charismatic frontman, musically the band was driven by its chief songwriter, a self-taught scholar of pop, John O'Neill.
Come all you young rebels.
We used to go on holidays in the summer to Buncrana or Bundoran, and there were like these folk bands playing all the rebel music.
For the love of one's country.
That was my first experience of hearing music live, I suppose. And there's some beautiful, beautiful songs like Bull of Vogue and Foggy Dew and The Patriot Game.
The Patriot Game.
But also at the same time, obviously, when you're you know, 12, 13, you listen to the radio and what's on the charts. And the charts at the time, it was a glam rock thing in particular. T-Rex, Gary Glitter. You got 3 minutes to make a statement, or even with T-Rex, some T-Rex songs are 2 minutes long. A big influence on me in an early age too had been early rock and roll, 50s rock and roll.
Why must I be a teenager in love?
And again, the library was quite good for early blues stuff. You could go down to the library and you could get the hair out, you know, Howlin' Wolf records and Johnny Hooker. And plus, especially with a lot of blues, Chuck Berry, Bo Diddley, there were just 3 chords of them. You know, it was easy to play.
The Patriot Game.
It was coming up to our GCSE O levels, and we did mocks, and I did very, very bad. You know, and it sort of worried me. I thought, you know, I need to start spending a bit of time, maybe doing a bit of studying sort of thing, you know, if I'm going to do any better in this.
In 1976, Vincent O'Neill, aged 16, left the band. Luckily, his kid brother wasn't a bad guitarist.
They tried a few guitar players, and it didn't work out. So the last resort, they ended up getting me. You know, it was the best thing that ever happened to me, obviously, because I felt part of a gang all of a sudden. It was really good.
At 15, Damien was the baby of the band, although all five were still in their teens. Too young for pubs and clubs, it was here, in the front room of the O'Neill family home, that the Undertones began to absorb the musical influences that would come to form their distinctive sound.
O'Neill's house was the place where I went every day.
I did everything on O'Neill's apart from sleep.
Fergal then would go down there. We would just sit in O'Neill's house, play some acoustic guitar, listen to records, and talk rubbish all night. And it was absolutely brilliant.
The boys had a strict but eclectic music policy, taking in 60s British R&B, pub rock, glam and American rock and roll, blues and garage bands. And then this happened. In 1976, the Sex Pistols launched their anarchic assault on Middle England.
For many people, it's a bigger threat to our way of life than Russian communism or hyperinflation.
The Undertones became a self-proclaimed punk rock band. But unlike London, Manchester, or even Belfast, there was no live punk scene in Derry. And stranded far from the action, the band found itself drawn more to the records coming out of New York than London.
Christmas 1976, I was told that my brother was going to buy me a record. He didn't ask me himself, so he asked my sister, which one would I want? I ended up with the Ramones, first LP for Christmas. And anyone who was alive in 1976 will remember the Ramones' first LP, because nothing had ever sounded like it before. So fast, so simple, just stripping it all down to the basics. This was where it all started, absolutely. The Ramones' first LP completely reinvented rock and roll.
Beat on the brat, beat on the brat, beat on the brat with the baseball bat, oh yeah.
In 1976, no one else was singing such simple songs, you know. And funny songs.
Through records and radio, the Undertones sought out other stateside punk bands, discovering music that owed more to American rock and roll than anarchy in the UK.
It was almost like joining the dots for us, you know, hearing the New York Dolls and the MC5 and the Stooges and the Velvet Underground. It was like, this is what rock and roll is supposed to be about.
We just decided to start a group, so we borrowed instruments, we learnt a few songs, and hey presto.
By 1977, the Undertones had a well-rehearsed set of R&B, glam and punk rock covers. London's punk bands had the Marquee, Manchester the Electric Circus, New York had CBGBs, but all Derry could offer was a makeshift shack and a bomb site called the Casbah.
It's been said that it was a porta cabin which had been plastered on the outside and placed over a hole in the ground where a former pub had been until it was blown up. The Casbah was the hippie stroke alternative stroke indie scene in Derry. That was the only place you could go to, this pub where they didn't mind what religion you were, but they also, they would welcome anybody.
The Undertones debuted at the Casbah on the 10th of March, 1977. It became their spiritual home for the next 2 years, and a godsend to a bunch of disaffected Derry kids desperate for any kind of scene to call their own.
For me, it was the first live experience of a group I've ever seen. So we sat there and we sort of sat in the corner, and it was amazing. It was just a great, dramatic night.
They were just exciting, and they were different, and it was ours.
There was a different crowd too, I suppose, that went there, and that sort of made it that bit more unique as well.
I suppose we all became a wee bit of a community, because, I mean, at that stage the band had no sort of recognition. I mean, we were the only people that sort of knew they were any good. So, I mean, you were sort of a group of sort of believers.
15 years before the peace process, the Casbah became a humble retreat for a generation that refused to be defined by Derry's deep-seated sectarianism.
I got to know this guy called Gordy, and he's from the waterside. Like, when he's chatting, I go, and I came out, and he happened to be a Protestant, and I just clicked. I said, that's the first time I've actually known that I'm talking to a Protestant, and it means absolutely nothing to me. Like, you know, it's just, he's on the same music, he's on the same ideas and stuff like that, and I thought, I was just here to have a carry on, a good crack, get away from reality.
You couldn't ignore what was going on, because you lived it. But it wasn't there when they were playing. Something else was going on as well. And that was, you know, that was political as well, because it was a challenge. It was different. Yeah.
You know, a whole community of a family of people that met through the Undertones for whatever reason and became friends. So therefore, you just felt like a big family.
We were absolutely aware of how people felt that was, we were expressing how they felt. That was a large motivating fact to when we did get signed up, that we stayed in Derry, we didn't leave, because we felt we were part of that whole scene anyway.
In the summer of 1977, inspired by the regular sessions at the Casbah, 19-year-old John O'Neill wrote the Undertones' first original song.
The idea was, every week we played the Casbah, to have either a new song or a new cover version. And it just seemed obvious to me, anyway, that, you know, if you play these three chords, so that three-chord trick, that try and come up with a few words along with it, couldn't be that hard. First one I showed to the band was I Told You So, which was a basic R&B rip-off. I wake up in the morning, I've been looking for a break.
Then somebody tells me you've been sleeping in too late, I told you so. Me, Mickey, and Billy actually contributed various songs, whatever, over the years, but John, he's just got it, you know. Most great bands have got an amazing songwriter.
I was just trying to get words that sounded right. That beat movement thing of first thought, best thought, and the less you thought about it, the easier it was, you know.
By the end of the year, the Undertones had a full set of original songs and were ready to make a record. Well, it's too late to stop, I told you so. There was nowhere to record in Derry, but there was a guy in Belfast.
I suppose as an old hippie punk, to me, was my hippie's revenge in the world. You didn't listen to us in the 60s, now look what you've got.
The Belfast scene was characterised by the muscular political punk of Stiff Little Fingers, who raged about rubber bullets and car bombs. The boys from Derry had something slightly less obvious to offer.
At the time, I was quite friendly with Terry Hooley in Belfast. I'd heard that he was starting to record some young punk bands in Belfast. I'd said to him one occasion, look, there's a band in Derry, and, you know, I'm convinced that they're better than any of the bands in Belfast. You really should get them up. So I pestered him for a while, and eventually he said, look, OK, there's a thing happening next weekend about Queen's Battle of the Bands. We'll get them up to play the Battle of the Bands, and we'll get them into the studio.
On June 15th, 1978, the Undertones stole the show at Terry Hooley's Battle of the Bands. Go! And the next day, they went into the studio and recorded the four tracks that would make up their first record.
Got a chance to do four songs. It was called Teenage Kicks EP because we were teenagers, more or less, you know. So it's just a good sort of title for the EP for four songs. We prefer True Confessions.
As far as I was concerned, anyway, the best song on it was True Confessions. But it was obvious that because we're going to call the Teenage Kicks EP, that should be the first song on the EP, you know.
Something of a happy accident, because the title track would come to be regarded by some as the most perfect pop record ever made.
Just the first few seconds of it, everything you enjoy about a certain sort of music comes with it, because they've tapped into it like an aerial. They've tapped into it and they've brought it with it. So you're not just hearing a cheap, shoddy guitar through a cheap, shoddy amp play obvious chords. You're hearing millions of other things floating through it. It's everything that they'd been influenced by, and they were influenced by the best things. They had incredible curating tastes, if you like, which we think of it nowadays.
Emerging from the front line of a major conflict, the Undertones could claim greater cause for voicing anger and rebellion than any of their punk peers. Instead, they sang a song about a teenage boy's frustrated yearning for a teenage girl. Poignant, universal, and profoundly ordinary. Unfortunately, none of London's record companies were interested in the Undertones' juvenile lament. In fact, the world might never have heard it if it wasn't for a maverick DJ at BBC Radio 1.
And that's the end of tonight's programme, in which you heard The Desperate Bicycles, The Slits, The Mekons, Alternative TV, The UK Subs and Sham 69. More of the same unpleasant and disorientating racket on tomorrow night's programme. Until then, from me, John Peel, good night and good riddance.
I said, why don't we phone John Peel? I think he mentioned Slit Little Fingers, and I says, well, we're better than Slit Little Fingers. You know, that's how cocky is that. So I pick up the phone and I says, my name's Billy, I'm phoning from Northern Ireland. And straight through, and she picks up the phone and goes, John Peel, you know, hello, who's this?
This afternoon, I have one of those embarrassing experiences when you're talking to someone, you're both speaking the same language, and neither of you can understand what the other one's saying. And I was speaking to a member of the band The Undertones, who come from Londonderry, and the chap I was speaking to, and I must admit it was a long-distance line, so obviously it wasn't too clear, but it got such a strong accent, I did have difficulty figuring out what he was saying.
He couldn't understand what I was saying, like a really broad Derry accent, so I had to speak very slowly. And I mentioned to him about there's a band from Derry called Undertones. We've recorded an EP, but it's not released yet. And he says, well, look, when the record comes out, send it over.
And he asked me to play something for a whole bunch of people there in Derry. And I've probably got some of these names slightly wrong. And if I have, I apologise to all of those concerned. But the names seem to be Eddie McLaughlin, Joe Breslin, Paddy Crawford, Dick Tucker, the McGillies, the McGamleys, I think it was, Maleys, and anyway, all of the band's fans in Derry, and I'm sorry, as I say, if I got the names wrong.
So finally, when the Teenage Kicks EP came out, I phoned John Peel, and I said, this is Billy, you know, I've been speaking to you on and off for the past few months. We now have the EP.
We knew he was playing it that night, so we were all in our in Beechwood Avenue.
I'm like, yeah, we got a record. Not only did he get a record played on Radio 1, but John Peel played it as well. We're absolutely so delighted.
Thanks to John Peel, in the autumn of 1978, listeners all over Britain got to hear the Undertones. Among them, a genuine music biz mogul from America.
I was driving down to one of those little seaside places about 90 minutes outside of London, and my head was killing me. And the one relief was we were listening to John Peel.
The Peel Show was on the radio, and Teenage Kicks came on.
Paul McNally is driving, and I start yelling at him, pull over, pull over. He turned white. He must have thought I was having some kind of attack because I was complaining about my headache.
Yeah, there was a bit of excitement in the car at that point, I think.
I said, Tim, I've got to sign this band. They are fucking amazing. It's unbelievable. What a voice and what a song. I think it's one of the greatest records of all time.
Seymour Stein, the man who 4 years later would famously sign Madonna, owned Sire Records, the American label whose roster included the Ramones. So you think you're so clever, never in doubt, but after days after hearing Teenage Kicks, Stein dispatched Paul McNally to Derry to sign the Undertones.
We had the comical scenario where we went to Fergal's house for a meeting with Paul, and he was going to tell us the details of the contract. And there was us, five in the band, plus we had all our friends, 10 all the year, 12 people. In good faith, we thought, Fergal and Mickey will go to London to meet Seymour Stein. We'll sign the contract meanwhile here in Derry for Paul. They'll go over there and they'll negotiate a bit more, and maybe if it's good enough, they'll sign.
In October 1978, two lads from Derry arrived in London to play hardball with the man who signed Madonna.
Fergal smoked at the time, you know, he would smoke like that there and go, I just look at a guy like that, you know, and you would think, oh, I'm dealing with a really shrewd character here, but I think Fergal had no idea either. He would smoke so he could,
You had Savvy Seymour Stein Record Company, Mogul, talking to two Waynes, basically, who'd haven't a clue about anything about the music business.
He must have thought he was dealing with two idiots. And you know what? He was.
I remember vaguely them trying to renegotiate at the last minute.
They phoned us, and I said to Michael, we'll ask him how much he's going to give us. And it was like 6,000. And I said, 6,000 each or 6,000 what? He says, 6,000 between five of us over 3 years. 6,000 fed about five over 3 years. That's not a lot of money. So I got on the phone again to Michael and says, Michael, say to Seymour, we want 100,000.
Billy was certainly shouting in the back. The Rich Kids got 60,000. The Rich Kids, Glenn Matlock's band, they signed to EMI. I says, the Rich Kids got 60,000. And Seymour went.
I could hear Seymour in the background going, you guys are crazy.
What do you want me to say?
So Seymour came over, took the phone off Michael, and I think he made some offer of, I don't know what it was, 30,000. Out of sheer panic, I said, that's fine, that's okay, that's the deal.
I think originally it was 8,000, we managed to up it to 10. But the royalty rate was shocking. I think it was worse than the Bay City Rollers, and they didn't even write their songs.
My only memory is that I signed them. In the end, that's what counted.
Whatever the terms of the record deal, Sire immediately re-released Teenage Kicks as a single. And just weeks later, the Undertones, a band used to playing to 100 fans in the Casbah, made its debut in London for a TV audience of over 10 million.
At number 38, first I'm in Undertones and Teenage Kicks.
I remember she must have bought them or something, but my mother had a pair of new pajamas for me because, you know, it's almost like a hospital stay. You're staying in a hotel, you're going to London, you're not going to show us up.
Oh, my aunties bought me pajamas. They go over to the Top of the Pops. First time I was ever on an airplane, I was 18 years old. Never out of Ireland, never on an airplane, and armed with tons of pajamas.
Britain's musical landscape was shifting. The Undertones formed part of a new wave of music inspired by punk and independent in spirit that challenged the corporate rock and smooth pop that had come to represent the mainstream status quo.
They're a young band, they come from Ireland, it's the Undertones and Jimmy!
The bands that bands like Undertones were influenced by, they were not getting anywhere near Top of the Pops or the charts or the mainstream world. They were obscure bands, and the Undertones were in that period just after punk when suddenly the records that previously you would have only heard on John Peel and wouldn't have been in the charts suddenly started to break into the charts. That was the great moment of a new kind of strange, peculiar, lovely pop music actually getting into the charts.
In the north of Ireland is Derry. From Derry come the Undertones, and with Here Comes the Summer is over there.
Ooh, baby. What can I do? You know you drive me crazy when I'm looking at you.
Three more singles from the Undertones' first album made them regulars on Top of the Pops.
Here comes the summer.
But at a time when the charts began to open up to ever more shocking and extravagant acts, what was most remarkable about the Undertones was that the band and their songs were so down to earth, they seemed positively exotic.
Predominantly, the songs are just about, you know, fun and games with your mates. That seems to be the general message. They were absolutely being themselves. And I think that's why people found them so attractive, because there was this tremendous honesty about what they were doing.
They were just nice kids who seemed sort of uncorrupted and sweet, and you can see why they wrote about Jimmy and Here Comes the Summer and Teenage Kicks, because there was an innocence to them. This rather cheerful Derry ordinariness.
But back home in Derry, the Undertones' ordinariness had special meaning. A significance brought into focus when, in 1979, they played a concert at a local school.
They were on Top of the Pops on Thursday, and then they were in my school on the stage on Friday morning.
The Undertones created a universal soundtrack to growing up. The everyday world of their music had particular resonance at home in Derry, were an ordinary adolescence was something the band and audience alike could only have imagined.
Looking back, you can see that there was more to it than they saw, I think. They were able to put into words what a lot of us felt, and they were able to show the dimension of our spirit, because our spirit was bursting to get out because we'd been suppressed for so long. These children would see shootings and bombings, and their houses would have been raided, their brothers would be in jail, or their brothers would be dead. Battle! I wanted them to see that there was a light at the end of the tunnel. Battle! So I feel that they were saying that, maybe just they were just saying that they were young and they wanted to enjoy themselves and they wanted a bit of freedom and they didn't want to be stood on, you know, and suppressed.
In Derry and throughout Northern Ireland, the Undertones gave an alternative voice to a generation caught in the crossfire of their turbulent times.
One way to understand it is as an alternative to what was really going on around them. I mean, if you came from Derry at that time, almost the most rebellious thing you could do is be ordinary. I went to see them in concert in Ballymena, which is this terrifying Protestant town north of Belfast. Jenny, Jenny. You know, the street had armoured vehicles in it. You know, there was police with guns everywhere. But once you'd gone in there, it was like a big youth club. The kids that were running around were so grateful that here was a band that wasn't singing about getting blown up and the IRA and the Troubles, but was singing about ordinary things. They were like a window onto the kind of life everybody else takes for granted. Jimmy, Jimmy,
oh. I still was at a wedding about a month ago when they played Jimmy Jimmy. Like, I'm at my good age, and I was like a child. Just that excitement, it's still there. It's just fabulous.
In 1980, the Undertones released their second album, a record that took them beyond the three-chord punkish thrashes of their debut, bringing their tales of everyday life and love to a much broader audience.
I was starting to really get into Velvet Underground around that stage. I love the slow songs. That juxtaposition of these experimental things with these lovely, soft, beautiful songs. So Wednesday Week was my attempt to write a slow ballady type thing.
I remember thinking, we're going to be okay. We're going to last a few more years if John's going to come up with songs like this.
But the biggest song on the album, and the Undertones' biggest hit, wasn't from John O'Neill. It came courtesy of Michael, Damien, and an unsuspecting relative by the name of Kevin.
I was sitting in a pub in Derry having a quiet pint with some friends, and another friend of mine came in and sniggered in my general direction and said my ears must be burning. I had no clue what he was talking about, and it was only later on in the evening that he said that I should go talk to my cousins in the Undertones. Now I've got a cousin called Kevin. He's sure to go to heaven.
Always spotless, clean and neat, as smooth as you'll get him. Myself and Damien were working on it for quite a while, and it was kind of based on a real life cousin of Damien's. Very unfairly, but sure, life's not fair.
Quite a bit of stick. There are certain lines that people would sing at me. I suppose at the time I was probably a bit annoyed about it. Now it doesn't cause me any difficulties at all. I can see the fun in it.
My Perfect Cousin, a comic rant against swotty relatives, was the Undertones' only top 10 hit. Hip film director Julian Temple was hired to shoot the video. And the location for this domestic drama was, of course, the O'Neill's house in Derry, where the English film crew got their first taste of what it's like to live in a militarised town. Now I've got a cousin
called Kevin. We had a cable coming out from a house, and we were lighting this thing. The next thing I knew, I was slammed up against the wall with a machine gun against my head with this kind of 15-year-old Cockney skinhead saying, "What the fuck are you doing?" He always beat me as a booty, and it kind of made a lot of sense that despite the real hard facts of war and bullets flying around, they were singing, you know, things about cousins who got on their nerves. There was also a real innocence there compared with the kind of London punk scene. So when I got there, I thought, this is amazing, because it's a really kind of different family kind of world, you know, like you imagine the 1940s or something like that. They were deeply entrenched in this culture of Catholic Derry and were able to find poetry in it.
It was a little bit like some kind of surreal soap, you know, that they were creating a landscape full of their chums and relatives and mates and people they'd bumped into. Very mundane, very domestic, and it seemed, oddly enough, quite punk too, to talk about stuff that wasn't Americana. It actually seemed part of their down-to-earthness that was actually quite potent.
Oh, yes, I like that one. My perfect cousin from the Undertones. And right now, it's time for our perfect inflatable Scrabble.
As well as chart success, the Undertones earned a reputation as a formidable live act.
They had this power live that a lot of bands just never ever get together. They became one of the best live bands that I've known.
But whatever ambitions their record company and management team might have had for them, the Undertones were unusually indifferent to life on the road.
We used to have a phone right here, and many a time, me or John would be sitting on the stairs going, "No, but it means leaving home for more than a week. We don't want to do that."
They would come away from Derry for 3 weeks and 3 weeks only. They would do a six-week tour, but they would need to have a week to 10 days break in the middle of it.
Billy and myself were really bad in the sense that we hated leaving our wives, or, you know, our girlfriends that became our wives or whatever. Myself and Karen were just like so madly in love that it took a shine off having to leave. You know, it was like, because we were both in tears leaving the house.
We just missed each other so much. It was that simple. You know, we just yearned to be with each other.
Getting a girlfriend was a big deal for boys whose music seeped teenage angst. But there was more to their attachment to home than the pull of young love.
They seemed troubled by the fact that they had to enter what they deemed already then to be a kind of routine. They were already feeling that somehow they'd compromised themselves, because there was a very pure punk spirit in the air back then, that you didn't do certain things that looked like you were compromising yourself. And to some extent with them, that even meant leaving their town, leaving their house, leaving their girlfriend. All these strange things to them were a compromise. It meant they'd sold out. And they hadn't sold out, you know, not by any means. They'd just begun to have success, but they didn't know what to do with it. They didn't know how to process it.
In September 1979, the Undertones supported The Clash on an American tour. This was a chance to break America and to party with perhaps the hippest band on the planet.
I was on that tour, The Clash tour in America, with the Undertones on support. And it was an incredibly unbelievable... I mean, you know, you'd be literally walking into a room and Andy Warhol would be in the room. But somehow my memory of it is the Undertones were like shadows. It's almost like they felt that they wanted to be this kind of group, full of integrity, and suddenly they were in the equivalent of The Sound of Music or something.
The reason I wanted to be in the band is not to party or to take drugs or drink or whatever. I just wanted to play my drums, and I wanted to play my drums with my mates. So I found it hard to cope with, to be honest. I was actually relieved to get back home.
You know, I've worked with a lot of bands where they go out all night and experience the town, you know, Munich or Budapest or Barcelona, and stay up all night and, you know, experience what that is for. But no, it fairly early to bed.
We didn't play the game, and we didn't want to play the game. We hated that rock star crap that you were fed limousines and, you know, it's again, it was back to that punk rock street thing. We were part of the street. We didn't want to be rich and famous.
So sad to see you've got silver. She's gonna break it.
For many bands, success offered the chance to leave behind their normal everyday lives. Not for the Undertones, despite the ongoing violence and conflict in their hometown.
Julie Usher, always on fire.
The release of their third album in 1981 coincided with one of the darkest episodes of the Troubles. After a period of relative calm in Northern Ireland, a series of hunger strikes by Catholic Republican prisoners brought violence back onto the streets of Derry.
The hunger strikes were carried out by Republican prisoners, IRA prisoners, who were demanding political status. They were in prison, having been sentenced for bombing, shooting, possession of arms, murder, attempted murder, etc., etc. So as far as the state was concerned, they were criminals, and serious criminals.
To treat them as prisoners of war or give them special political status is to give them a license to kill.
On the other hand, Republicans regarded themselves and were seen by their community sort of as taken part in an uprising, if you like.
Although the Undertones had previously avoided writing about the Troubles, they found the hunger strikes impossible to ignore.
It was in the streets everywhere around you in Derry. It was Belfast, Northern Ireland. You couldn't escape it. You couldn't get away from it. It was a really, really grim time. So I tried to write a song about it. Turned out to be It's Gonna Happen.
Happens all the time, it's gonna happen, happen.
It's gonna happen all the time is about hunger strikes, because Ireland's got a history of hunger strikes from way back.
Happens all the time.
Until you change your mind, until the government changes their mind. Basically, it was very quite crass. So I give it to Mickey. So can you rescue this song?
I can't remember if he said this was about the hunger strikes, but I decided it wasn't going to be about the hunger strikes, because I still hold to that it's very difficult to write something good and valuable about a situation like that. So I came up with verses which are vaguely alluding to someone in trouble.
Top of the Pops on tonight's show. We've got some great stuff. We've got Shaking Stevens, we've got Pinwild, we've got Toya, whole host of good things. Starting off with the Undertones, and it's gonna happen.
Happens all the time.
Good evening from Belfast. The province is quiet after the early morning rioting that marked the death of Bobby Sands.
Coincidentally, the night we did Top of the Pops was the same evening Bobby Sands had died. As a sort of mark of respect, I thought it'd be a good idea if we all wore black armbands. But when it came to doing it, they didn't refuse, but they just, no ways. But I did it anyway, because I did feel that angry about it. I wasn't trying to make statements saying I support the IRA, but I did sympathise with the aims of the hunger strikers.
Millions of Top of the Pops viewers were oblivious.
There you go, what a good way to start off the programme. Gorgeous stuff.
Do you mind?
But for the first time, the Undertones were attempting, with characteristic bashfulness, to reflect something of the momentous events they were living through.
Strangely enough, although the Undertones were more affected through their community by the hunger strike than any other contemporary band, yet it was out of character for their band to be commenting on those things. And once again, you see sort of that the Undertones are really a very complicated phenomenon, a complicated musical and cultural phenomenon, very complicated political phenomenon.
It's Gonna Happen reached 18 in the charts in spring 1981. It was to be the Undertones' last top 20 record.
Good evening, good people of Hitchin, and anyone else who's just joined us. Once again, Sight and Sound comes from the Regal Theatre, and I'm sure you'll be only too glad to be reacquainted with a band who we haven't seen or heard very much of for the last year or so. So please welcome, all the way from Derry, ladies and gentlemen, the Undertones.
I always say we split up because we didn't sell records. If Sin of Pride, it's a record which I don't like, but if that had been a success,
we would probably have stayed together.
It makes me wonder how to read your understanding. Makes me wonder what's in your mind.
In March 1983, the Undertones released The Sin of Pride, their fourth and, as it turned out, final album.
We just knew we weren't going to have a hit single. And also we knew that Fergal was not happy in being in a band who maybe got good reviews, but were struggling financially. I remember saying, well, if you make good records and you get a good review in the NME, will that be enough, you know? And I said that to Fergal. He says, but you'll not be happy with that. And he says, nope. And then I saw writing on the wall.
None of the three singles from the album troubled the top 40. And as record sales declined, the band and its lead singer began to drift apart, as differences that had lain dormant until now began to surface.
As the Rolling Stones say, it's a singer, not the song. You know, I knew that. Like, it's like the song's only as good as the singer. And I was getting more and more frustrated at the way Fergal sang the songs. Fergal wasn't really into music, you know. As I was listening to things, I had maybe a certain idea in my head the way it should be sung. Trying to get Fergal in to listen to things, to give him an idea, it's this kind of way that I'm thinking that the song should be. He was always dismissive. He'd go, I'll sing the song the way I think it should be sung, you know?
John was very, very protective and very precious on his music. And I don't mean that in a negative way, it's just the way he was, you know? And there was kind of maybe that personality clash, probably Fergal had different aspirations, and all that was kind of starting to come to the surface. So I think he had enough of that. And to be honest, if it was me, I'd think the same as well. I'd say, look, I had enough of this. I'm a good singer. I'm actually a better singer than what you are musicians. I'm going to head off.
Finally, in May 1983, the Undertones decided to call it a day.
We were in Sweden, and there was a photographer taking photographs of us. And for some reason, we weren't playing ball with the photographer. Fergal knew this was happening and just said, right, boys, that's it. And before the sound check, we had a wee sit-down meeting, and he says, he's probably smoking. And he says, I said, I'm leaving the band. And no one argued with them. No one says, oh, why, what's happening? We all kind of knew.
There was no fun anymore, and it was almost like someone's got the balls to do it. That was great. So let's just break up.
Then again, that's what's good about being a band. You look at the Beatles, they fell apart spectacularly too.
Five years, four albums and 13 singles after bursting onto the scene with Teenage Kicks, the Undertone story was over. But coming from the darkest of places and situations, their enduring achievement is to have created timeless music of startling positivity that touched teenagers all over the globe while daring a generation at home to dream of a life more ordinary.